Hey, welcome back to High Level Tips for Programming in Chialisp. So in this section, we want to cover tips and tricks that my colleagues and I think about when we're trying to ensure the security of a smart coin. In general, you want to allow as narrow a hole in the wall for values to be changed as possible. Because parameters can be input to your coin at spend time, that is a serious attack surface because your spend is transmitted across the network and there's no way to stop a farmer changing that spend, or rather the solution that you gave, except by tying those solution inputs to the puzzle that the coin is attached to in some cryptographic way. So almost all of these things you should be worried about have to do with tying the puzzle of the coin to the solution parameters. One of the most common tools that we use is checking signatures. What we call the basic or the vanilla transaction is a smart coin, just like any other. And the way it works is when it's created, we embed a public key in that coin's puzzle from the user's wallet. So we know that this user and only this user has that secret key that corresponds to that public key. And we also know that their wallet will be able to find that public and private key again when they need them to issue the information needed for spends. So we'll go over signatures a little bit, not in depth, but just enough to drive home the point that it's a way to be able to tie the trusted key root of your wallet to a particular coin. In many cases, you want that in conjunction with something else. Or if you have a more publicly usable coin, you may not want a signature. You may just want to check things in Chialisp. We'll get to a more concrete example. If you can keep only one thing in mind before you publish any smart coins to the blockchain, think through every single branch in your program, every piece of data that's passed in from elsewhere, and ask yourself, can this be changed? Can someone put in a bad value here and cause something unexpected to happen? Hopefully you've considered what that is and that will be checked, abort your program, and then the spend will fail. So the first family of things that you can use to check truths about your coins are the asserts. Here they are right here. So we're going to be considering these four asserts. You can see below that there are also timed asserts. You can probably guess what those are. We're not going to cover them, but assert seconds, relative, and family are a nice way of time gating, making sure a transaction doesn't happen before a certain time. This may look like a lot of things to cover. Let's back up a little bit and refresh our memory of what a coin is. Here's the Python definition for the Chialisp coin. We have the parent coin ID, which is a hash of all the information in the coin. We have the puzzle hash, which is a hash of the puzzle that is attached to that coin. And then we have the amount, just the amount of money in that coin. Coin ID is the amalgamation of those three pieces of information. So really, this is just a broken out way of being able to assert only one of those pieces of information if it serves your purposes. But if you need them all, just use assert my coin ID. A good example of when you would use assert my puzzle hash is if you want a coin to be able to live through state transitions, or if you want there to be a family of coins that are all governed by the same puzzle, then assert my puzzle hash will only check that they are being run with the exact same puzzle. So that allows for different amounts and different parent coins, and therefore different coins, to be governed by the same puzzle. If you're not checking my amount and you're not checking my parent ID, just check in assert puzzle hash. If you do have a coin that keeps its identity, that is, carries in new information, that'll create a new puzzle hash, and that introduces a complication for you because you now know that the child coin that you create when you spend is not going to have the same puzzle hash as you. So that's going to introduce a little bit of complexity into your code, and you'll have to keep that in mind when you are making your other assertions or condition checks. A Chialisp program is a program like any other. So of course, argument checking is a thing. Most of these are sort of standard things that you think about when you're programming, except in this case, your program is moving money. So you really want to check every branch and check every value. One nice thing is that Chialisp only has two types of things. It has atoms and const cells. So there aren't a lot of different types or data formats. So you won't have a proliferation of if statements just checking different types or different dictionary entries or things like that, unless you're developing quite a sophisticated contract. One of the things I like to keep in mind at the forefront is when I'm dealing with numbers, all Chialisp numbers are essentially infinite precision integers, and they can be negative. So always check for negative numbers if you are accepting inputs from the outside world. Many programs would find it useful to check the range of values. Like if you're developing a game that's only supposed to deal in pocket change, you should really put in the check that no one's spending 1,000 Chia or, you know, a number that's absurdly large. Another special value to be aware of is nil. Like in many languages, nil or zero can cause different checks or functions to behave differently. So that's a good one to look out for. If you do a parameter check and that fails, you should use the X keyword. That mnemonic is short for exception, and the intent there is just to abort the program right away, not to evaluate one more term. Once X is called, you're guaranteed that your spend will fail. So make sure if you have a case that doesn't make any sense, like the last clause of an if, make sure and put X in there instead of, say, nil if you really mean for it to fail. Don't depend on the rest of the program to abort. And lastly, there are, of course, checks that are run outside your program. The assert family of conditions, as well as signatures, when you output them from your program, they cause code to be run in the Chia blockchain itself. And that code is very simple, specialized, and efficient. And if one of those is present, you really want to let the system check that for you. Don't go recoding a signature check-in or ID verification. I mean, some of these things can't be checked by your program, but don't be tempted to do that in your program if those conditions exist. If you see a condition and it sounds like what you want, come to our Keybase channel and ask if that can be made to work for you. We haven't written every smart coin yet. Speaking of signature check-in, we have two commands built into the CLVM that deal with BLS primitives, and we also have several condition codes that deal with check-in signatures. The one we're going to talk about is agsigme. And this confusingly worded condition means aggregate signature. We'll explain how to use this a little later. But basically, the first argument is a public key, and the second argument is a message. That message can be anything, but it's usually the hash of a collection of other data. And that other data can be in any format. It can be a string of bytes. It can be a list of lists, whatever. But the key is that whichever private key that public key is attached to has the ability to produce a signature of that message that will pass the agsig check. All right, that does it for the security tips section. After this, we're going to drop down out of this high-level overview and try and give you a bit more of a practical example of some of these concepts. So definitely come back for part 3, and I'll see you there.